Clout by Jesper Klit, read by Russell Bentley for Saga Egmont. Introduction. Clout. Throughout my career as a communication coach and media advisor, I've had the pleasure of working with scores of competent and committed managers and employees, from mid-level managers to prime ministers. Among these, you find some of the country's best communicators, people who over time have developed strong, personal clout. The fundamental, unifying principle that characterizes these individuals is that they are good at dealing with other people. We might describe them as having charisma and lots of energy, or we might say that they are convincing, that people fall for them straight away, that they fill us with enthusiasm, engage us, and see who we really are. Basically, we are discussing their ability to create an emotional bond with other people. The word communication is derived from the Latin word communicare, which means to share something with one or more people, particularly through language. Try to take a moment to consider a competent communicator you know and have seen in action. Most likely, he or she has a well-developed emotional intelligence, as well as a radar, which reads other people's emotional states of mind accurately. Skillful communicators would also have sufficient self-knowledge to understand how a given situation would influence emotionally. In other words, they have people skills. This book is about people. Or more precisely, the book concerns you and the ways in which you can develop your personal clout and optimize your communication. Personal clout, defined as the ability to make an impact and influence other people, is a competence increasingly in demand when managers and employees are hired. And with good reason. We no longer have confidence in or distrust ideologies, institutions, traditions, political parties, or companies. We relate to real people, of flesh and blood, and in this context, it makes good sense that personal clout, in our day and age, is a high priority requirement. The good news is that efficient communication and clout can be learned. However, realistically speaking, very few of us will become a new Barack Obama. Still, that should not prevent us from trying. The fact is that through coaching and developing an awareness of the quite simple techniques that govern our communication, we can all increase our personal clout. A well-known aphorism states that knowledge is power, and of course, this is true. The same goes for communication. The most efficient communicator, and the one who has the strongest personal clout, wins the order, the woman, the man, or half the kingdom. In a time characterized by an excess of communication, we as individuals, as well as the companies we represent, must work hard to get noticed. In the midst of a tidal wave of information, some of it regular noise, we compete for attention. If you cannot get the customers, the coworkers, the managers, or your partner's attention, then you have a major problem. In this context, one should also consider that companies and organizations, to an increasing degree, and by virtually all interested parties associated with the company, are asked to give coherent answers to quite a number of questions concerning everything from the environment to occupational safety, employee satisfaction, and economy. The increasing focus on the company's license to operate means that organizations have to make an effort to ensure that managers and employees are able to function as qualified ambassadors. These representatives should have professional and convincing skills that enable them to formulate and communicate the company's principal values, positions, and stories in ways that generate permanent market advantages for the organization. The ability to design, formulate, and communicate personal, commercial, and political visions and ideas in such ways that a broad spectrum understands and feels the message is increasingly important. In this scenario, it is not just top managers who need to apply themselves to improve their personal clout. The rest of us should also take this challenge seriously. Every day we have encounters or meetings where our personal clout determines whether or not we are successful. The ability to mobilize a maximum of personal clout is not only crucial with regard to making our mark in the public sphere, it is just as important in relation to the many communicative challenges we all face every day when we meet a customer, a coworker, or the manager, when we do a presentation, have a job interview, negotiate, or contribute to a debate, etc. All things considered, it makes good sense to include development of your personal clout in your business plan. In modern working life, success to a great extent depends on our ability to build relations, form networks, and profile ourselves. That is the way ahead, whether we like it or not. Managers should not just have superior professional skills, they must also be capable of designing and sending out messages. The ability to communicate professionally with external and internal interested parties is an increasingly significant managerial competence. Furthermore, some of the most important future success criteria will be transparency and accessibility. The most efficient managers are very conscious of the ways in which they are perceived by others when they communicate. They are aware of the fact that body language, personal energy, eye contact, dress code, charisma, and the ability to motivate other people create important competitive advantages, or vice versa. Not to mention the fact that clear communication generates satisfied and committed employees whose enthusiasm translates to obvious results on the bottom line. Time and again, research shows that communicative competences such as personal clout, the ability to create a dialogue, motivate and engage the employees, and communicate the company's vision and mission are at the top of the management's want list. This book is written for those of you who have the desire, as well as the drive to develop your personal clout, thereby increasing your ability to become even better at generating understanding and credibility when communicating with other people. The book is structured so that chapter by chapter, you will increase your insight into your own communicative strengths. This will help you get an overview of the areas you can improve. I recommend that you read the book cover to cover. However, the book is designed in such a way that it can be used as a manual or a reference work, where you can quickly get an overview of the specific areas and acquire knowledge of techniques, tools, and communicative competences within the framework of the 7 habits that characterize the good communicator. I have attempted to give the book the format of a practical, efficient, tool-oriented guide. This guide will help you develop the communicative competences whose cumulative effect will strengthen your personal clout and make you a better communicator. I wrote the first version of this book almost 10 years ago, when the global and political landscape, especially in the U.S., was quite different from today. But although times, leaders, and communication platforms change and evolve, I firmly believe that your ability to succeed as a leader or specialist now more than ever is closely linked to your ability to move people and perceptions, and do it fast. The fundamental premise of this book is that whether you are the manager of an international organization or a day nursery, you will need to apply your personal clout to communicate efficiently in order to succeed in getting your point across by becoming conscious of the techniques that strengthen and enhance communication. You can learn to turn on your personal clout. This book provides a detailed insight into the 7 most noteworthy habits of some of the best communicators in the world. The 7 strong communication habits are: Habit 1. Know yourself. Good communication begins at home, and in this context, self-knowledge is the key to communicative competence. Actually, it is quite simple. The better you know yourself, the better your opportunities will be to optimize your communication. We begin by getting an overview of your communication paradigm. To a great extent, your convictions and values guide your behavior, your thoughts, and your communication. For this reason, it is important that you identify and challenge your convictions, because they might either inhibit or improve your communication. Then we identify your communicative growth areas, the specific competences that you wish to develop in order to enhance your personal communication. Towards the end of the chapter, we will try to identify your type in terms of your communication and what signals you send out. Habit 2. Plan your success. If everything communicates, and it does, how could you design your communication to achieve the desired effect? What should you be aware of before you enter a communicative event? How do you prepare yourself in the best possible way for a meeting? How do you turn any nervous tendencies to your advantage? How do you get to know your audience or your target group in advance? And how do you design a communicative top performance? In this chapter, you will receive some good advice and ideas as to how you create an advantageous position for yourself when meeting other people. Habit 3. Coordinate speech and body language. Plainly speaking, your body is a telltale, and you might as well get used to it. Within the first few seconds of a meeting, we judge each other solely on the basis of a visual impression. Reading other people's thoughts and attitudes based on their appearance is an ingrown trait inherited from our hominid ancestors, whose spoken language was limited. In this chapter, you will by and large be introduced to everything there is to know about body language, active listening, appropriate eye contact, movement patterns, voice, gesticulation, facial expressions, hands, posture, touch, mirroring, pacing, rapport, physical appearance, executive presence, assertive communication, attentive presence, your ability to command a room, and other means of reinforcing your personal clout with a view to ensuring that your speech is coordinated with your body language. Habit 4. Stage yourself. The way you stage yourself is crucial with regard to the ways other people perceive you. The ability to stage yourself significantly is part of your personal clout, and it is not reserved for leading politicians and managers. We all stage ourselves because we realize full well that our clothes, car, home, education, glasses, circle of friends, interests, etc., signal who we are and how we want to be perceived. In this chapter, we will take a closer look at what it takes for your staging to become authentic, efficient, and trustworthy. In the section on intermediate level staging, we also take a look at how you best apply high status communication in order to increase your personal clout. Habit 5. Involve your audience. For professional communicators, conscious involvement of customers, audience, constituents, etc., in communication is a natural consequence. They have long since realized the dialogue is the only valid communication. People with strong personal clout are often very skilled at including others in their communication. But how do they do it? And how do you create the best possible interaction with your audience or your conversation partner? In this chapter, we take a closer look at these issues. Habit 6. Design and tell efficient stories. Storytellers, especially the skillful ones, have always been in great demand. When the elite in pre-revolutionary France gave dinner parties, the best storytellers were seated at the tables of the nobility. The better your skills as a storyteller, the closer you were positioned to the people in power, notwithstanding dress code and social position. In a figurative sense, this is in many ways still true. Managers with strong personal clout are also often good storytellers. Thanks to their ability to formulate and communicate significant stories, anecdotes, and examples which represent the values, the vision, and the mission of the company in vibrant and personal ways, they succeed in generating an understanding of the change they advocate. In this chapter, we will take a look at how you become even better at designing and telling efficient stories. Habit 7. Train your personal clout. In this chapter, you will get a number of concrete tools and methods, as well as inspiration, that can help you to actively develop and train your personal clout in the future. You will get some suggestions as to how you, as a manager, can ensure a genuine and continual feedback on your communicative performance. All good communication begins with yourself. If you think you are either competent or incompetent, then chances are that you are completely right. Self-knowledge is the key to communicative competence. The better you know yourself, the better your opportunities will be to enhance those elements that function and scale down aspects that are not advantageous in communication. Welcome to a service checkup of your communication paradigm. Habit 1. Know yourself. A few years ago, I received a call from a minister in the Danish government. He asked me if I could possibly help him improve his communication skills on TV. I could see why he called. You did not have to be the Einstein of the communication world to observe the striking difference between the politician in question on and off camera. When addressing his constituents and discussing various issues with them on his campaigning tours in Denmark, the politician performed with excellence and strong personal clout. However, in front of a television camera, something strange occurred. His speech became peculiar. His facial expressions changed. His gesticulation became quite awkward and artificial. When on TV, he could hardly walk naturally. However, his underperformance was not caused by lack of training in media communication. He had had plenty of coaching in the field. In fact, a small army of communication advisors had counseled him in survival strategies on TV. The problem was that no traditional coaching advice had had any visible effect on him. My first step was to ask the minister to set aside 2 days for media training. The busy man's advisors wondered and hinted that I needed to have my head examined. The reason that I requested a timeout of 2 entire days was that if the minister, after approximately 7 years in office, had not learned how to make even a fairly good appearance on TV, then there were strong indications that there would be no quick solutions to his problem. In subsequent interviews with the minister and several people close to him, it was confirmed that the dilemma was deeply ingrained in his personality. This type of setback takes time to solve. In order to improve the scenario, the politician and I met on a Saturday morning and began a 2-day media coaching session. First, we watched television. To get a better perspective on the minister's performance on TV, I had brought along approximately 20 taped interviews, from his first appearance on screen to an interview recorded only a few days previously. We began by laughing out loud at the minister's first performance. "How dreadful! It is torture to watch it again," he said, and I did not disagree. Then we studied the next clip. "Untalented," he responded. His comment to the subsequent scenario was, "Try again." The following take he acknowledged with, "Oh well." When we had seen all the clips and got to the most recent interview, we made the connection. Suddenly, the minister understood that he had gradually improved his skills as a television communicator over the years. Of course, his point of departure was less than impressive. However, there were signs that a dynamic process had begun. The minister had made progress and had no doubt improved his communication skills. The most important change on this Saturday morning was that the minister changed his present communication paradigm. "I am not a good TV communicator, and I never will be." His new angle was, "I'm not a great TV communicator, but I have definitely improved my skills over the years." In other words, the minister now saw a potential for development where he had previously seen a wall. The reason that I tell you this anecdote is not that I want you to believe that the minister became a veritable Obama in just a few days. Nothing of the sort. However, something happens to us when we are forced to identify and challenge our often rigid paradigms and convictions. The reason is that our convictions, to a great extent, control our behavior, thoughts, and communication. For this reason, it is important that you identify and challenge your convictions, since they might inhibit, or further, as the case may be, your communication and personal clout. The point is that it is possible for us to alter our behavior by consciously changing our mindset and convictions. In plain speech, if you believe that you are capable or an incapable person, then you are right. Your communication paradigm. We are rarely aware that our convictions translate to rules of conduct, which either inhibit or further our personal clout. The following list of statements illustrates some of the limiting convictions I often encounter as a communication coach. I will never learn it. I am an inferior communicator, and that is just the way it is. People don't listen when I speak. My communication quite simply does not make an impact. I am not on top of the world when I attend meetings. I do not have the necessary self-confidence. When I make a presentation, I am always unsuccessful. I bet my audience will not be inspired by my presentation. When I do a presentation, I am certain that my audience assesses me as incompetent and uninspiring. I am at my best in writing. I am nervous, and it is obvious to everyone. There are more important things in life than communicating. My performance is always mediocre in large gatherings. I think that communication is difficult and demanding. I focus on the business aspect. It virtually goes without saying that if the statements listed above represent your convictions, also called your communication paradigm, then it will be difficult for you to communicate successfully. Hence, it makes good sense that you should become aware of the convictions that control your behavior, especially those that restrain your performance. Your limiting convictions. Spend a few minutes considering what your convictions are in terms of communication. Write down some clues as to the limiting convictions which might possibly hamper your personal clout. In my media training courses, I meet a particularly high frequency of people who are very nervous about being interviewed on television. When I ask them what the problem is, they often refer to the actual upcoming situation with answers like, "Because I have never been on television before," or they might say, "Because I am not used to being the center of everyone's attention." However, when you question them closely, it often turns out that the source of their nervous tension is their own thoughts and conceptions of the situation, which they often associate with making mistakes, the mind going blank, stammering and stuttering, making a fool of oneself, and not being able to give adequate answers. In other words, they are primarily afraid of their own thoughts. Some months ago, I worked for a recently appointed manager of a major company, who in his new job often needs to address and motivate the approximately 1,500 employees of the organization. The new manager was to a great extent governed by the conviction that he always made a bad impression when confronted with a large audience. A limiting conception of this kind often entails that you attend the meeting with low self-reliance, that you get into a state of mind where you spend a lot of energy on a negative interior dialogue, that you attempt to avoid the situation. This was precisely the case with a manager who, during the first months of his new job, did what he could to avoid getting into situations where he had to address many employees at a time. When he had to go on stage to say a few words, for instance at the annual summer party, he did so with such low self-confidence that he made a bad impression. In the manager's own words, he experienced the situation as follows. It was a vicious circle. When preparing for such an event, I spent a lot of energy imagining all the things that can go wrong when I'm in the actual situation. I might be at a loss for words. The employees cannot be bothered to listen to me. There are technical problems. There is too much noise, or the assembly is too quiet, and so on and so forth. None of these things ever actually happened to me. However, the fact that I imagine that they could happen means that I deliver a suboptimal performance. I am quite simply losing on points before I even go on stage. This attitude and lack of self-confidence has the effect that I, so to speak, never catch up with myself. It goes without saying that this manager needs to change his attitude. In order to work seriously with the development of his personal clout, he will have to exchange this negative conviction, regardless of its origins, with a new and more positive firm belief in himself. The mere fact that an inexpedient conviction is verbalized creates an awareness that can actively contribute to breaking the pattern. In this case, I initiated my media coaching by subjecting the manager's principal convictions and basic communication paradigm to a thorough and critical service checkup. Among other things, I asked him the following questions. What factors contributed to the conviction that your performance is always inadequate in large assemblies? Is it something you believe, or do you know for a fact that this is so? How does this conviction influence your self-conception? How does this conviction affect your self-confidence? In what ways does this conviction affect your communication with other people? What concrete steps could you take to change the conviction that your performance is inadequate? How could you formulate a liberating conviction that addresses this issue? Of course, the method described above is not a magic formula. However, when you take charge and cross-examine your limiting convictions, there will be a positive outcome. In the best scenario, you will discover that perhaps no rational reasons support your conviction, and that you, by looking the limiting conception straight in the face, often may be able to form a basis for the creation of a new and more positive pattern of action. In the case of the manager, we altered, or rather, he himself altered his conviction from, I always underperform in large assemblies, to I occasionally communicate quite well in large assemblies, especially if I plan an introduction, which makes me feel confident and ensures that I get off on the right foot. There is a telling difference between the two self-conceptions. Invariably, positive thoughts and attitudes have a proven track record of leading to increased self-esteem and self-confidence, resulting in improved performance. Exercise: a service checkup on your limiting convictions. Take your point of departure and your recently completed list of convictions that restrict your personal clout. Ask yourself the following questions and write down the answers. What are the factors that contribute to my conviction? How does this conviction influence my self-image? How does this conviction affect my self-confidence? In what ways does this conviction affect my communication with other people? What concrete steps could I take to change the conviction that my performance is inadequate? How could I formulate a liberating conviction with regard to this issue? Exercise: which convictions strengthen your personal clout? When you have carried out the previous exercise, you should take a few minutes to consider and write down which convictions strengthen your personal clout, the aspects of your communication which you are good at. Convictions that strengthen my personal clout. People with personal clout will often associate themselves with statements like, 1. I'm good at keeping in touch with my feelings. 2. People listen to me when I speak. 3. I like the company of other people. 4. Usually my body language is relaxed. 5. It is easy for me to make contact with other people. 6. Small talk is the social glue that might lead to big business. 7. I find it easy to cooperate with other people. 8. When I step into a room, I make contact with other people, also people I do not know. 9. I often look forward to making a presentation or chair a meeting. 10. I have natural eye contact with the people I talk to. 11. It is easy for me to make decisions. 12. I generally listen to other people and expect that they listen to me. 13. I have a high level of personal energy and it is contagious to my surroundings. 14. I know what I stand for and what my strong points are. 15. My professional contribution is interesting to other people. 16. I consciously apply myself to install hope in other people because I know that hope generates action. 17. I have confidence in other people. Self-knowledge is the key to communicative competence. In fact, it is quite simple. The better you know yourself, the better your opportunity will be to enhance those elements that function and scale down aspects that are not advantageous in communication. Self-knowledge is the key to communicative competence, and efficient communication begins at home. Evidently, elements like self-esteem, self-assurance, credibility, authenticity, knowledge, and confidence in other people are central ingredients which constitute your personal clout. With some justification, you can say that body language, facial expressions, gesticulations, attitude, and voice serve the purpose of either enhancing or weakening your clout. Self-confidence is often a function of having an ability to turn things around. A finance manager may, for instance, have self-confidence in terms of taking charge of the economy of the organization. A lawyer may have self-confidence because he or she has legal expertise. Self-assured people know what they are good at, what they represent, and that they are capable of achievements that command respect and attention. Making a contribution does not automatically give you self-esteem. On a basic level, self-esteem tends to be a result of self-acceptance and liking oneself, as well as the belief that you are important as a person. People with self-esteem, which should not be confused with self-satisfaction, are well-balanced and do not depend on what other people think and expect, nor do they rely on the reactions to what they do. Credibility is based on a coherent relation between what you say and what you do. People who have credibility are characterized by being genuine, attentive, competent, committed, and ready to engage in dialogue where they make reasoned statements. Authenticity signifies that you are yourself, just the way you are, and that you do not attempt to play a role of some sort. Authentic people are true to their basic values, and in communication with other people, they express their true needs, emotions, and opinions. With regard to confidence in others, it is actually quite simple. You reap what you sow. People with personal clout almost always express great confidence in others. They believe in the best features of their fellow human beings, and in return, other people have confidence in them. Concerning competence and knowledge, people who know what they are talking about are naturally ahead on points in terms of personal clout. This is particularly true if they are also capable of translating complex contexts into words and concepts that are understandable to their target audience. Often there is a distinction between formal and personal clout. The formal clout tends to be based on a number of external factors. For instance, the moment you become a manager, formal clout will be part and parcel of your position. Here you will automatically get attention when you speak. On the other hand, personal clout is defined as communicating your messages successfully by applying your personal resources. Over and above distinguishing between formal and personal clout, you will also feel the difference between the traditional and the modern roles of communication. In a simplified way, you could describe the difference between the traditional and the modern communicator as follows. The traditional communicator is characterized as based on a power relation, monologue, focus on controlling the relations, non-involvement, dependent on the role, being in control. The modern communicator is characterized as based on the ability to establish a license to communicate, dialogue, focus on establishing relations, involvement, independence of the role, being in charge. There is no doubt that in many ways it is easier to be a traditional than a modern communicator. The primary reason is that the traditional communicator bases his or her communication on a power relation. This ensures that he or she controls the communication, which is in mono. On the contrary, the modern communicator faces a number of complex challenges. This is particularly evident when it comes to establishing an actual dialogue with the interested parties. As we will see later, this entails that the communicator is able to manage his or her personal clout. Once we have identified your convictions, we move on to discuss the visible issues that characterize your behavior. If self-knowledge is the key to communicative competence, and it is, then it is important that you are capable of assessing the ways in which you communicate and how other people perceive you. Exercise. Describe yourself as a communicator. Taking your point of departure in the 25 characteristics listed below, you should explain which type of communicative behavior describes you in the most accurate way. You can give each description points from 1 to 5 in accordance with the degree to which it illustrates your behavior. 1 point means no agreement, and 5 points means full agreement. You as a communicator, on a score of 1 to 5. Listening. Vibrant. Open. Willing to engage in dialogue. Good at small talk. Motivating. Have a high level of personal energy. extrovert. Involving. Aware of the recipient's response. Questioning, use humor. Have an animated body language. Engaging. Easy to read. Calm. Straightforward. Convincing. Attentive. Ready to admit mistakes. Good at receiving feedback. Good at handling emotions. Speak fluently. Good at creating a constructive atmosphere. Respectful. Naturally, you perceive yourself in a certain way, and other people see you differently. In my experience, most of us have a, let us be diplomatic, limited insight into the effects we have on our surroundings. This observation stems not only from the hundreds of communication workshops I have taught. My experience is also based on the self-evaluations of many managers and employees. Often there is a glaring contrast between the signals we think we send out and the way the receivers experience the communication. The classic example is that of the manager who gives himself a top mark when asked, "How good are you at listening?" or something to that effect, while his employees shake their heads and give him a non-pass in the same question. Even if it may be a barrier-breaking exercise, you could try to ask a friend or colleague you trust to attempt to describe your communicative behavior. To what extent does your own self-conception deviate from how other people see you, and why? Discuss this with your colleague and find out how other people see you and why. It almost goes without saying that the purpose of this exercise is not to change your basic identity. However, if you want to communicate efficiently, you should begin by forming an accurate picture of what characterizes you as a communicator, the signals you send out, and the ways in which other people perceive you. In my experience, this exercise may take some effort. It is not always easy to ask other people for feedback on your communication and the impression you make. If it is any help, I can reveal that it is precisely this type of feedback the star communicators of this world apply as part of their communication routine. The purpose is to actively ensure that they are constantly updated on the effect their communication has on various target groups. In other words, if Barack Obama, Bill Clinton, and Tony Blair can do it, so can you. Be aware of the fact that it is not just your active communication that characterizes you and influences other people. It is, to a great extent, also the absent communication, such as, for instance, silence, blank faces, turned backs, the missing smiles, and statements made in a negative tone of voice. Everything communicates, and the experienced communicator is extremely aware of this. Case: introvert or extrovert. In a recent communication workshop, someone asked, "Can an introvert communicator have clout?" My answer was, "Yes, why not?" Introvert and extrovert are descriptive characterizations of people who are predominantly either reflective or outgoing in their associations with others. In a simplistic version, people who are predisposed to be extrovert are often individuals who feel more energetic when they are in the company of others, individuals who have a large circle of acquaintances, individuals who like talking to strangers, individuals who like and often excel at small talk, individuals who are attracted to the external stimuli found in interaction with others, individuals who act while they speak. People who are predisposed to be introvert are often individuals who are fond of spending time alone, individuals who choose not to socialize with a lot of other people, individuals who prefer in-depth conversation to small talk, individuals who are self-reflexive, individuals who are attentive listeners, individuals who think before they talk and act. It is important to stress that we all apply our introvert as well as our extrovert aspects. However, we are predisposed for one of the two. Your communicative growth areas. Below, I have listed some of the elements which alone and by virtue of their cumulative effect characterize the strong communicator. I suggest that you spend a few minutes selecting 3 to 5 communicative competences which you wish to develop in the near future. Exercise. Select 3 to 5 communicative competences which you would like to develop. Your ability to see yourself. Your ability to see yourself as others see you. Your ability to give feedback. Your ability to receive feedback. Your ability to focus your communication on the receiver. Your ability to arouse interest. Your ability to inspire other people to commitment. Your ability to apply examples. Your ability to tell stories. Your ability to create contacts. Your ability to activate other people's emotions. Your ability to create confidence. Your ability to listen actively. Your ability to use humor. Your ability to ask questions. Your ability to be present in the moment. Your ability to acknowledge other people. Your nonverbal language. Your ability to apply language. Your ability to handle conflict. Your ability to communicate your vision. Your ability to make complex issues simple. When you have selected 3 to 5 communicative competences that you want to develop, it would be a good idea to ask yourself the following questions. 1. What is the purpose of my development of the competence in question? 2. What concrete actions can I take? 3. How do I want to do it? 4. Who might I want to involve in the process? 5. When will my project succeed? What is my success criterion? What type of communicator are you? The greater the insight and clarity you have about who you are as a communicator, the better opportunities you will have to develop in the desired direction, thereby strengthening your personal clout. Human beings are different, and for this reason, there is great variation in the types of communication we use. In the following, you will find a more or less simplistic description of 5 types of communication which vary in terms of personal clout, characteristics, body language, strengths, and weaknesses. Please read the descriptions and consider which type of communicator you are, or would like to be. The technician. Driver. Perfection. Characteristics. Logical and analytical. Technical. Communicates on the basis of facts. Is realistic. Critical. Likes numbers. Body language. Closed. Controlled. Dominant. Is objective and emotionally detached during the dialogue. Uses facts to underpin point of views. Difficult to read. Much experience in keeping a neutral poker face. Limited gesticulation and facial expressions. Talks in short, precise sentences about factual issues. Relatively monotonous speech. Examples: Xi Jinping, President of China. Gordon Brown, former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. Anders Fogh Rasmussen, former Secretary General of NATO. Vladimir Putin, President of Russia. Strengths: usually communicates clearly. Is understood. Is often convincing. Weaknesses: the communication can seem harsh or cold. Can part ways. Limited empathy. The emotionalist. Driver: indignation. Characteristics: controlled by emotions. Very communicative. Empathetic. Likes to talk. Body language: open and inviting body language. Uses emotions to support points of view. Often mirrors the interlocutor in the dialogue. Animated facial gestures and gesticulations. varying expressions with quick eye movements.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.